No.
It's tomorrow. But tomorrow doesn't really come until you've been to bed and woken up. Who is my passenger? Who am I taking for a drive into tomorrow? The theatres are shut. And the cinemas too. Buses have stopped running. And the last tube has gone home to bed. This time of night is so far from where he wants to be that he needs a taxi. It might be a doctor summoned in the night. It might be a reporter working late with a story for the morning papers. Perhaps it's someone after a party, or someone who sat up late talking to friends. It's usually just that. Nothing but exciting. But London at night still excites me, after driving in all the Londons that have been since I started 20 years ago. I remember the sparkling pre-war West End, with its glamorous air of money being spent unwisely. Then there was the black, dramatic town of the war years. And now there's this wide, empty London of tonight. Oxford Street. Non-traffic regulated lights. Only ones left. Look at them, winking and blinking away as if all the buses and lorries in the kingdom were stopping and starting. Round the Marble Arch. Here's Park Lane. The old Kent Road doesn't get a special shampoo like that. Now, who is my fare?
Taxi!
Floor white milk bar, Fleet Street.
Right you are, sir.
Taxi!
Taxi! Taxi! Taxi! St. George's Hospital, please, quick!
People seem to think you're part of the fittings of the cab.
Here you are, Jock, King's Cross.
Leaves up, I suppose. Parade 08:30 hours. As I remember. Brr. Look at these waiting for the last train. Was it worth it? The extra couple of hours at home? There's no place on earth like a station in the first hours after midnight. There's a sort of damp and draughty chill, and you're indoors and outdoors at the same time. Yet stations thrill me, even though I am used to them. There's a smell about them. The clock that jerks with a sound. And the sudden drama of a train. The night Scot, roaring out in its narrow northern journey, out and away from the station with its station smell, into the clear countryside, among the trees and the fields, to Scotland, leaving us behind. And these? Bundles? Corpses? No. They're waiting for the first tubes and buses. And by the way they lie, you can guess they've done this before. Often, in this long war that's over. Now the train has gone, and the station is filled with an echoing silence. Any small noise is thunder.
Evening, mate. Cup of tea to roll, please.
You want a cup of handle?
Thanks.
You want a chump?
Thanks. How's business?
Be able to retire soon and buy a taxi.
Don't be here.
So this is London at night. Dead as mutton.
Dead? London?
So I said to him, had he ever worked on a newspaper? Did he know what was going on at this very minute in every big newspaper building in London? Tomorrow. No, we are tomorrow. Today's paper. 800 copies a minute. Waterfalls of them, pouring down with a noise like, well, like Niagara. See the corner sticking out? That's for checking. Every 26th paper. How's your 26 times table? Country mail vans, country editions, off to the four corners and to your breakfast table. Why, I could have talked about the papers forever, but he didn't seem very interested.
It's about all that does happen, then.
All? What about the mails? Here.
So I tried to make him see Mount Pleasant Post Office, biggest in the world. No, it's not Christmas. Just an ordinary night where the hands unceasingly flip over the letters, taught by the trained eyes that can read even your writing. Toss them into the right pigeonholes, ready for stamping. 700 a minute. And the post office's own toy underground rail. Letters as passengers. And the whole thing's worked by switches.
Thank you.
that trouble over the line you scribbled to your Aunt Violet?
Cup of tea, please.
Cup of tea. Milk?
And that's another thing. Milk.
Then I told him about the milk rattling in on the early trains, being rushed to the depots. The bottles being washed. The automatic control that prevents the bottle being used unless it's clean. Look at it, marching along for all the world like a regiment of tin soldiers. Only they're made of glass. And the filling on a sort of merry-go-round. It's like a conjuring trick, isn't it? Empty one minute, full up the next.
Oh, milk.
What about Covent Garden, pal?
Well, it's a bit early yet. It'll take you long to see for yourself.
I used to set me alarm clock for 2 a.m.
That's right. I used to drive through the garden on my way home at 4 or 5 a.m. After my day's work, mind you.
And then I told him about all the vegetables and fruit arriving cold and frosty from the country fields. Covent Garden's a small place, only 5.5 acres. But Spain meets South Africa here, and Kent and Devon. And the warm Scilly Isles send off their fruits and flowers to this grey yard. Yes, oranges. And at last, bananas. Not in your shop, perhaps. But some kids are going to have a treat before this day's over. Yes, I'm fond of the garden, all right.
Yes, but milk, mail, newspapers, vegetables. I'm just not interested, that's all.
You would be if there wasn't the,
I still say it's as dead as mutton. Good night.
Yeah, where are you off to?
Ebury Street. Why?
Oh.
You wouldn't like to.
Just get into my cab. It'll mean a bit of a way around, but I'll show you something that'll really interest you.
I don't. What?
Oh, that's all right, that's all right. That part of it's on the house. Good night, lads. This way, sir. There she is.
I don't want to run all around London, but I've got to get home sometime.
Wouldn't tell him where we were going, but he'd asked for it, hadn't he? Dead as mutton, London? We passed the British Museum, and I told him of a pal of mine who used to be night watchman there. Had strong nerves, he did. Had to have. Beam of his little torch making the huge figures move and the blackness blacker. And everything so old and famous. The men who made them dead and forgotten this 1,000 years. Not my job. Trafalgar Square and the Admiralty Arch always makes me think of an empty house with the lights left on by mistake. Here we are, Houses of Parliament. You see that light above Big Ben? Means the house is still sitting. Here they come. A lot of schoolboys kept in. Night workers. Our elected government. Take your choice.
Oh, sorry, sir. Engaged. What was the debate about?
About it.
My taxi! Now, I know what you're going to say. I'm just not interested.
Well, I...
What you need is a course in economics. Where do you be without money? Always talking about it? Spending it? Or saving it, if you've got any sense?
You'll be telling me next to save yourself.
Of course I do. Clock up all I can. No point in silly spending nowadays, especially when you pay more to get less. Besides...
So I told you, I'm saving 4 pounds. You know, a nice little place of my own someday. Holidays for the missus and kids. Same sort of things as you. Things we want and can't have now. And considering the job this country's got to get things really moving again, it stands out a mile to me that saving is essential.
Oh, thanks. I shall remember what you said. Good night.
Good night. Looks as if he started his savings campaign already. Well, well.
Taxi!
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 Taxi!